In today's video, we're going to be having a look at the latest smart switch by Sonoff, the NSPanel. We're going to be having a look at what the product is, some of its features and functionality, and if you do stick around till the end, I'll be showing you how to add it into your Amazon Echo, and of course, Home Assistant. Check it out. What's going on, guys? I hope you're all doing well. If you follow me on any of my social media accounts, then you will have seen this device pop up a few times in the last couple of months. But before we get into what it is and what it does, there's a couple of things that I want to just point out here. First of all, full transparency as always. I was given this product for free by Sonoff for the purposes of testing, but I was never paid or even asked to create the video, and everything you see in this video are all my own personal thoughts and opinions. The second thing is that this is an early production unit, so things may change in the Kickstarter or by the time the actual product launches, so just bear that in mind. And the final thing is that at the time of recording this, the Kickstarter hasn't yet launched, so I'm not actually sure what the price of an individual unit is, but if you head down to the description below, you'll find a link to the Kickstarter, which will have now started. I'll be revisiting the NSPanel in a future video, but for now, let me know what you think of it and what you actually think of the cost in the comments below. So, what is this thing? To put it simply, the NSPanel is a smart scene wall switch. It replaces your traditional wall switch and aims to be an all-in-one multifunctional control center. It achieves this by making use of a full-color 3.5-inch touchscreen, which gives you various bits of information as well as offers touch control for various different smart home devices, scenes and groups. You also have two physical buttons on the bottom of the panel, which allows you to control the two relays. With the panel, you've got four different methods for interacting with it. You can make use of the touchscreen, the two physical buttons, voice control using either the Amazon Echo or Google Assistant. It also supports Alice if you're one of those guys. And you can also remotely control it by making use of the EweLink app. If you're wondering what the NS stands for, it stands for Nextion and Sonoff. So this thing makes use of a 3.5-inch HMI Nextion touch display, and in addition to that, it also contains an ESP32. Both of those components, the screen and the ESP32, are great for smart home enthusiasts as well as people that just like to tinker with electronics. Having these components opens future doors for things like custom firmware and moddability, and we'll be coming back to that a little later on. There's two different models of the panel. There's the EU version and the US version. Both panels are identical in terms of spec, they just have a different footprint. The EU version is a square design and the US version is a rectangle. I received the square EU version. It comes in a blue branded Sonoff box. On the outside of the box, you'll find all the relevant bits of information about everything that the product can do. And on the inside, you'll obviously find the panel itself, as well as an instruction manual and some mounting screws. To get the panel up and running and connected, you're going to need to have access to live and neutral wires. Now, unfortunately, here in the UK and in this current house that I'm in, I don't have access to those. And as I'm currently in the process of moving, I didn't plan on installing any extra neutral wires just to get this thing connected. So I could have just hooked up the panel to some power on my desk, but I thought I'd do something a bit different and I created a little development board. The board's fully reusable and it's really simple to swap out the switch so I can test other smart home switches. And I also left plenty of space in order to add extra electronics to it in the future. I tasked the question of naming the board to my Patreons, and two of the options we had were the Automation Station and Karen after Plankton's wife. Let me know in the comments below which of these two names you think fit the board. Back to it then, the panel's connected using Wi-Fi and utilises a 2.4 GHz network connection as well as the 802.11 standard. The panel's got two 2-amp relays which are drivable by making use of the four methods that we previously spoke about. As it's only 2 amps, you're only going to be using it with lights and you're not going to be hooking up big electric loads and machines, so if that's what you were hoping for, then you might be a bit disappointed. The dimensions for the panel are 86 by 86 millimeters for the EU version and 120 by 74 for the US version. If you're wondering how far it actually sticks out in the back box, it's about 30 millimeters. So as long as you've got a back box with a depth of at least 30 millimeters, you should be good to go. The main panel body, which houses the touchscreen and the physical buttons, attaches directly to the backplate and the relays. It does this through a small connector on the back of the panel, so once you've wired everything up in the backplate, you simply just push on the front plate. Once you've got it all wired up and powered on, you're going to need to set up the panel using the EweLink app. This is a straightforward process where you just open the app up and add a device. It will then just connect to the panel using Bluetooth, and it will pass over things like the Wi-Fi credentials. Once you've got it connected to your account, you can give it a name in case you've got multiple different panels. You can also set its locale, which will allow it to set its time, its weather, and also its outside temperature all automatically. The display on the panel's okay, but it's nothing really to shout about. It's not the sharpest or the most clearest, but I guess it's been chosen for a reason, and I think that reason is to just keep the cost of this unit down. One gripe that I've got with this screen is that it's got really poor viewing angles, so if you're not dead centered looking at it, it's actually quite hard to see what's on the screen. Now, this isn't that big of an issue because if you are using it as a touchscreen, then you are going to be stood in front of it, but maybe if you wanted to just glance at it to check the time or to see what the temperature is, and if you're not dead centered, then you're not going to be able to see that. The touch controls for the panel are what you'd expect, and the navigation's very simple. Pulling down from the top of the screen, as you would with a smartphone, reveals the brightness slider and the timeout settings. The panel's touch interface consists of three main parts. You've got the main screen, which shows you the time and date, as well as the temperature for the locale you're in. You've then got the widget screen, which allows you to have a maximum of 8 different widgets on screen. The widgets can be other smart home devices or scenes. If it's a device, it steps into another interface that allows you to have more granular control over that specific device. So for this example, I was able to add my Sonoff LEDs as a widget, and I was then able to control the brightness and the colour of the LEDs. Just a couple of things to point out here. These other smart home devices have to be Sonoff products, and they have to be registered with your eWeLink app. The other thing to note is that the Sonoff Zigbee bridge isn't supported, so any devices you've got connected to that, you won't have access to. So in my example, I've got one of the Sonoff Zigbee plugs, and I can't access that as it connects through the Zigbee bridge. I did, however, come up with a bit of a workaround for this, and I was able to add the plug as a scene to turn it on and off. These scenes were then accessible in the NSPanel, so I could turn the plug on and off. I wouldn't say that this workaround's super practical though, as you only get access to 8 widgets, and there's not a way to set a toggle in a scene, so you have it either on or off. So by doing this with the plug, that technically takes up 2 slots of my 8 widgets. And the last screen of the interface is the thermostat. With this, you get access to a small touchscreen thermostat dial. Just below the thermostat gauge, you'll see a little minus and plus button. You can tap on these to increment and decrement the thermostat temperature. Another method for adjusting the temperature is to just drag the dot on the gauge. With the thermostat, you've got 2 different modes. You've got the manual mode and the automatic mode. The manual mode is self-explanatory, but with the automatic mode, you're going to need to set up a schedule that it will follow. To set up the schedule, you'll need to be making use of the eWeLink app. And from here, you can pick the time and date as well as how often the schedule is going to repeat. In comparison to some of the other smart home temperature sensors that I've got, I did find that the NSPanel was reporting a couple of degrees higher. Now, I don't know if that's because I was doing a lot of testing and touching the screen a lot, or if just that the temperature sensor on the panel is just quite sensitive. The panel's temperature sensor is located at the bottom of the panel, and it just sticks out through the bottom of the case. If you make use of the eWeLink app, you can also set up additional functionality to the physical buttons. You can add features like power on state, inch-in and interlock-in. And on top of those things, you can also set up things like schedules, timers, and loop timers, all to control your relays. Okay, so up to this point, everything we've seen and looked at is all based around the Sonoff ecosystem and the eWeLink app. But what about if you want to be external from those services? Let's start off with the Amazon Echo. So this one's a nice straightforward one. All you're going to need to do is just download the eWeLink skill, and once that's set up and activated, it will just auto-discover all of your Sonoff devices, and it will just find the NSPanel. Once it's discovered your panel, you'll be able to start making use of your voice to control the relays. You can control the relays individually, or you can control them both at the same time.
Turn on NSPanel outlet 2.
I was hoping that with the panel and Echo connected, that the Echo would be able to see the panel switches and be able to create routines based on those switch actions, but you're not able to do that. If you could do that, or it does get added in the future, that's going to be a really simple way of connecting your NSPanel to third-party products. So for example, on that button press, you could turn on a 2-year light or a Hue light. Okay, up next is Home Assistant, and I've been able to successfully add the NSPanel into Home Assistant by making use of a custom component by AlexIT. The custom component is Sonoff LAN, and it's available through the Hack Store. I'll have a link to it in the description below if you want to go and check it out. Using this custom component, I'm able to access channel 1 and channel 2. Which are the 2 different switches for the relays. It works well and it's near enough instant, as you can see in this video. Pressing the switch in Home Assistant updates the panel instantly, but going the other way around, pressing the switch on the panel takes a couple of seconds for it to actually update in Home Assistant. In addition to the 2 relay controls, you do also get access to 2 other switches, but I have no idea what these are. I did try toggling them on and off, but they didn't seem to do anything. I thought maybe they were the thermostat controls, but they're not. With this integration, you can also view some extra information in the attributes, so you can see what software version it is, you can see the humidity, and you can also see the temperature. For me personally, just being able to control those relays would be enough, as you could simply tie scripts and automations to the various states of the switches. So with my example earlier, where I said controlling a 2-year or a Hue bulb, you can just do that with Home Assistant. And all of this is possible on just the stock firmware, So with no changes or modifications being made. So imagine when this thing's been out for a while and people have had to play around with it and written some custom software. This thing could be quite cool. Okay, so what about the moddability and the hackability? This thing is a prime candidate for some custom firmware or to be flashed with something else, and I guarantee it won't be long before this thing is in ESPHome or Tasmota. Once the product gets off Kickstarter and gets out there in the wild, I think we'll start seeing a lot of big community changes for it, which is always a good thing for smart home enthusiasts. With the panel, I feel like Sonoff have purposely designed it in a modular and easy to access way. The panel comes apart simply, and all the GPIO pins are all labeled and very easy to access. And as I previously said, it really won't be long until somebody adds this thing into ESP Home, Tasmota, or something else. We're going to wrap this up now by going through some of the cons and the issues that I've had with the panel. But again, do bear in mind that this is an early production unit, so these things may be ironed out, or something that I'm saying is a con might not necessarily be a con to you. My first con then is to do with the display, and it's the fact that you can't change that wallpaper or change any of the icons, which you'd think you would be able to considering this is going to be on display in whichever room you have it in. Hopefully this is something that can just be added in a future update. Maybe you could choose from a range of different themes or even add your own photos. My next con is to do with the mechanisms. So with this, I'm talking about the touchscreen and the buttons. For me personally, I don't think the touchscreen is as responsive as it should be. So there's been lots of times I've tried swiping through the screens or adjusting the sliders or clicking something on the screen and it's just not registering properly. With the buttons, you have to press them directly in the center, otherwise it doesn't register properly as a click, which is quite annoying really, because sometimes when you press it on the edge, it feels like it is clicking, but it doesn't actually register. Sonoff did mention in an email that they're making some changes to the buttons, so I don't know if that means the batch after this one is going to have improved buttons, but I guess we'll find out. And my final con then isn't really a con, it's more of an improvement. So my improvement would be to add a look sensor or a motion sensor. The purpose of the look sensor would be to have the light change dynamically based on the lighting in the room. So if it was dark in the room, the screen would be a bit brighter, and if it was really bright, then the screen would be a bit darker. And the purposes of the motion sensor would be to have the screen light up when you approached it. I personally think both of those improvements are pretty solid, and who knows, we might see those in a future version. And there we go, that's been a little look at the NSPanel. If you've enjoyed this video, don't forget to drop me a like, and if you're not already, hit that subscribe button and ding dong the notification bell. You'll then be alerted to any future video that I do. As always, a massive thank you to these awesome dudes. These awesome dudes are my Patreons. If you're interested in helping support my channel, which in turn allows me to create content and videos like this, then you'll find a link to my Patreon in the description below. But thank you for watching, and I'll catch you in the next one. Cheers.